was faith that changed him, totally transformed him, and reshaped everything, and he would become now the one who freed him, or Umar, one of the greatest people of Arabs, who was also, who belongs to the tyrants before his time, if you like, who belongs to the masters and this kind of group. Now, Islam also reshaped him. They're talking about Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr is the one who freed Bilal radiallahu anhu. Umar, being from, you know, he has the class, he has the family, he has the tribe, he's from that famous tribe, and he's that Arab guy, and he's strong physically, he's everything. But then after Islam, he would say, Abu Bakr Sayyidana, Abu Bakr Sayyidana, Abu Bakr is our, now he's saying our master, not in the sense of master and slave, but our respectable person, our Sayyid, our, one of our leaders, wa'ataqa Sayyidana, and he freed our master. He freed, talking about Bilal, Umar talking about Bilal, and he said, Abu Bakr, this great figure for us, he freed from slavery the great, the other great figure for us. So Islam is actually reshaping all of that. If you want to look at it, you know, holistically or profoundly, you will find that Islam is reshaping everything, is reshaping everybody, reshaping the relationships. When you take this, you know, transformation, you know, don't expect it to come smooth. It's going to be coming with some challenges. But again, this is meant. Whether you will go with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go stick with the right decision that you know is right, you know it is the right decision, or you will give up on that because of some challenges here and there. Challenges will come, challenges will go. But always support will come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are serious about it. Whether they are newly Muslims, whether they are trying to come closer to Allah, it happens. It's not easy. And I know what I'm talking about, it's not easy. A sister was coming, young sister was coming crying to me in the office yesterday. I've been trying to come closer to Allah, pray, and it's challenging. The society, the time, the age that we live in nowadays, it's not easy, it's challenging. You don't think that others are better than you. You don't think, oh, I hope I was born Muslims, or I hope I... It's everybody has their own challenges in a way or another, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designed it in such a way that we are all equal. He is just, we are all equal. You might have some kind of challenges that I do not have. I may have some kind of challenges that you may not have. But in any case, alhamdulillah, that we are all brothers and sisters, and we try our best to support one another as part of our faith that Islam is teaching us. Any other thing that you want to share before we start, inshallah? So it's very simple in here. The first few lessons, let's get into level 6, let's get back to level 1. We're going to just read over it quickly. So level 1, lesson 1, lesson 1, the testimony of faith. Can I have somebody going quickly over this for me? If it's big enough. Is it? Anyone would like to volunteer? Objectives, obviously, we will study the objectives, the testimony of faith, and it is mainly to understand the importance of the testimony of faith and to understand the meaning of the testimony of faith. The Arabic term shahada, or testimony of faith, we will also understand the meaning, the word Allah Azza wa Jalla, one of the names of God, or his name as he chose, At-Tawheed, the meaning of oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So introduction, the core of the religion of Islam is attesting to two phrases, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. This is the foundation of Islam. You can do all the actions, but unless this is clear in your mind, you're not going to be a good Muslim or even a Muslim unless you really understand La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, or there is no God rightfully worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. The importance of the testimony of faith is, it is, as we mentioned, the foundation for anything that comes after that. If you say it and you mean it and you have it in your heart, then you can literally, the least of actions or words or whatever you can do, deposit in your account, it will count for you. If you do not have it, you're missing everything. You're missing the code. You're missing the password. You cannot even log on to your email. You cannot. It is to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to declare your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're shy, if you're arrogant, if you have anything to hinder you from that, then it's not there. You have to announce it and declare that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, not only when you accept Islam. After you accept Islam on a daily basis in each prayer, Shadu an La ilaha illallah wa shadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah, you say, and we do that in prayer physically and spiritually and with the tongue, with the heart, with the mind, everything, we announce it as a reminder. And we ask Allah to always ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, guide us the straight path. We always announce it in every single unit rak'ah of prayer. Iyyaka na'budu, you alone, Allah, do we worship. Wa iyyaka nasta'in, you alone, iyyaka, you alone, do we turn and, for help and assistance. It reminds us of the goal of our creation that Allah said about in the Quran, and He said, and I have not created neither jinn nor humans except to worship me alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make us except to worship Him. He gave us the free will to be able to choose, to be able to make the right choice and worship. And indeed we have raised, He sent messenger in every nation, in every group, as He said, and indeed we have raised amongst every nation a messenger, commanding them worship Allah and reject all false deities. So, the meaning of La ilaha illallah, the first part, La ilaha, Nova, you negate, negation of any God. And then the second part is ithbat or confirmation, except Allah. The first part of this phrase, which involves the rejection or the negation, that there's no deity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have a shariq, does not have partners. The idea of, you know, kings of our time who might have supporters and helpers and ministers. The idea of God and saints that will be God in by proxy, if you like. A saint who will intercede for you to God, who will take you to God. A saint or a holy person or a son of God, or all of these things that will do something or take one task of divinity. That in Islam is not there. It's Allah alone. And nobody is like Him. And no saints. Some people to respect, prophets we respect, people of knowledge, people of characteristics we respect, but we don't have any kind of deity. And all of deep we say, La ilaha. Nobody can benefit you, nobody can harm you. You don't go all the way travel for a saint to pray for a saint because he or she will you know, give you forgiveness or whatever it is that anybody, all of that is a divine work, is Allah, only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we believe no one has this part. Second part is the affirmation, except Allah. No one is right, even though many people will take gods, false gods, but this is not right. They don't deserve to be gods. They cannot. They don't qualify to be gods. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one God to be taken as true God. But other false deities, people may take them, but they do not qualify and they do not deserve to be gods. Yet they have taken besides Him other gods that created nothing but are themselves created, and possess neither hurt or benefit for themselves, and possess no power of causing death, nor of giving life, nor of raising the dead. So literally, if you look at Jesus, for example, as believed to be God or Son of God by millions of people, He Himself, honestly, this is a message for all our fellow Christians, to look at the very words of Jesus, peace be upon Him, even in the Bible, He does not, nobody controls His life. Nobody controls, you know, His death. Nobody can benefit others or harm others except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the world that's rewarded, that's going on around us is a big witness to that. That we are just coming and passing by and we are leaving, not choosing the time to come in, not choosing the time to leave. It's all by the permission of Allah as the one God. The meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. By testifying Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, you believe he was the last prophet and messenger. He came as the last of this team of all the prophets and messengers. No other prophet or messenger after him, simply because Allah said in the Quran, Muhammad is not the father of any man among you, but he is the messenger of Allah and the last of the prophets, and Allah is all aware of everything. Number two, what does it mean to believe Muhammad is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is to believe that he delivered the message of Allah faithfully, just as he received it without any deficiency. He gave us the message in full, as Allah said in the Quran. This was in the final farewell sermon, when he said, this day I have perfected your religion, Allah is saying, I have perfected your religion for you, completed my favor upon you, and have chosen for you Islam as your religion. So Islam was full and complete, and the message was fully delivered by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not deficient in any way, does not need anybody to come and add one partition here, one section here. It's full and fully delivered. To believe that he was a prophet to all mankind, to believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to all mankind. We believe this is the truth, and everybody should follow it. It is the only way for salvation. We don't believe he is just an optional, or Islam is an option. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave everybody freedom to choose, but we do not, it's not a table where you put Islam here, Christianity here, other religions here. It's not like that. Islam for us, the way we believe in it, is the same religion that was revealed to Adam alayhi salam and all prophets. It is the same religion that Moses, peace be upon him, told. It is the religion that Jesus taught, Ibrahim, Yaqub, Jacob. All of them taught it's one religion. Allah said, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. And whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, it's not going to be accepted from him. It's not various options. The true Christianity that Jesus, peace be upon him, taught is Islam. He was a Muslim simply because the meaning of Islam is submission to the will of God. And they all submitted to the will of God. To believe that everything he said about the religion was revealed from Allah. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Allah said in the Quran, he does not speak from his own desire. His speech is only a revelation inspired to him. Perfect revelation that's preserved and protected up until now. All of it is the actual word of Allah. And whatever he spoke about religion is from Allah. No worry about that, no doubt about that. He who obeys the messenger obeys Allah. Many ayat talking about that. Believing Prophet Muhammad also means we must worship Allah according to the law brought by him. He is the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is now the way. Simply like all prophets before him, they were the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were commissioned, hired, ministered, sent, raised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deliver his message, which is one. It's not different. It's the same exact message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, is one. Number six, what does it mean to believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Prophet Muhammad is to be loved and honored, not just as an option, not just to pray like him, but to love him and take him as an example. We would not be able to fully follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until we love him, or unless we love him. We will not be able to love him until we read about him, we study his life. You see how good he was, even to us, even to his followers who will come down the road, down the years, down the centuries, that he is praying for them and he is caring for them and he is longing for them. And he was caring for his friends and even his enemies. And he was crying that somebody is dying, without accepting Islam. Or he was crying out of happiness that somebody finally accepted Islam. That Allah, the one who sent him himself, would tell him, لَعَلَّكَ بَخَعَ نَفْسَكَ أَلَّا يَكُونُ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Take it easy on yourself, you are almost killing yourself out of grief for them that they are not believing. So he was passionately taking the mission to people. And part of believing in him is loving him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. I want to jump quickly to lesson number two, which is introductions to the pillars of Islam. I want to share with you a little video in here by Sister Kaya. She did it some time back. Simple video. Okay.
Five pillars of Islam are the things you have to do in order to be a Muslim and to show that you're devout. But first and foremost,
let's start it over.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to my channel. Today I would like talk to you and explain what pillars of Islam are the things you have to do in order to be a Muslim and to show that you are devout. The first and foremost thing you have to do is you have to take your shahada. This is when you declare your faith. You have to declare that there is no God but God and that Muhammad is the final prophet of God. You can say your shahada, but if you do not mean it sincerely in your heart, then it does not come. The second thing that you have to do is salah. Salah is your five prayers that you're supposed to do every single day. The first prayer would be Fajr. Fajr is the prayer that is right before the sunrise. The second prayer is Dhuhr, which is the early afternoon prayer. The third prayer, which is the late afternoon prayer, is called Asr. And the prayer right after the sun setting is called Maghrib. And the fifth prayer, about an hour or so after Maghrib prayer, is called Isha. So the third pillar of Islam is Zakat. This is when we give charity. It is not like the alms tax that you see in Christianity. The Zakat is when you donate a certain percentage of your money to charity or the needy or the poor. This does not include money that is given to the mosque. If you want to give money to the mosque or the masjid, that is from your own personal money. And zakat, again, it is mandatory to donate a certain amount of money every year. Saum is the month of Ramadan, having to fast every single day. There are some things that will maybe prevent somebody from having to fast, which that's fine. If you're diabetic, if you're sick, if you're pregnant, if you're on your menstrual cycle. There's several different reasons. And another thing I want to point out, pregnant women, sometimes they fast, and I really do not recommend doing that. God gives you a special treatment for a while. You should definitely take advantage of that and not take it for granted. And the final pillar of Islam is called Hajj. This is the religious pilgrimage that we make when we go to Mecca in Saudi Arabia. There's certain things that we have to do while we're there. If you cannot afford to go to Mecca in your lifetime, God will understand it completely. It is very expensive, I can understand. Some people save money for their whole entire life. I know I cannot afford to go to Mecca, but I hope someday, inshallah, I will be able to go and do Hajj. Again, I want to say thank you so much for watching today's video. If you have any other questions, please send me a message or message me on social.
Okay, so this is a beautiful introduction, simple introduction of the pillars of faith, and our Islam, our faith is not complicated, it's very simple. Imagine if you do that, you will just go to Jannah, inshallah. A person came to the Prophet ﷺ saying, Ya Rasulullah, tell me, what do Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make obligatory on me as far as prayer? He said, five prayers. He said, by the one who has sent you with the truth, I'm not going to do any extra prayers, only those five. He said, what do Allah make obligatory on me as far as sawm, fasting? He said, month of Ramadan. He said, by the one who sent you with the truth, I'm not going to fast anything else, only Ramadan. And he kept with the five things. Then he said, and then he turned away. The Prophet ﷺ said, aflaha in sadaq. Successful he will be if he stick to that. So, these are the obligatory things of Islam, the pillars of faith. Some of them you might not even get the chance to do, like Hajj, for example. Hopefully, inshallah, everybody will get the chance to. But for me, the philosophy of these, obviously, we know these for, you know, we practice them every day or constantly. Testimony of faith for me, let's make the comparison between the soul and its need for the spiritual nutrition, the religious nutrition, the divinity or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's nutrition versus the body and its need for various things. Testimony of faith of shahada for me is just like the air. It's like the air, you need it all the time. You need to have the faith and carry the faith all the time that you live with it. Without it, you know, if you have any doubt in it, even a small, the person is, the ground itself, the foundation is affected. The prayers for me is like food and drink, food and water. You need it constantly. It's not as essential as the Shahada, but you need it on a constant basis that you cannot survive without it. It's a daily thing. And then Sawm for me is like the medicine. Some of the medicine is preventive, some of the medicine is cure. Sawm is us to, you know, to be able to trim this tree, to cut, to keep, you know, your desires in control, to keep, to raise your awareness and consciousness about God by getting closer to Him, and to cure some spiritual diseases by, you know, you following your desire, or you are not able to control yourself, this and that. So it comes as a treatment. And I was thinking, what could zakah help me? What could zakah be like? And then Hajj as well. Zakah, we know, is a blessing. It's for blessings, for protection, for prevention. It's like work. You are healthy, you have food, you have water, you have air, but then you have to work. You have to work. So zakat is this kind of work, it is this kind of evidence, is this kind of what you pay back to your bigger family. If you make enough money, specific money that you have to share with the bigger family that you belong to, bigger family of Islam, bigger family of humanity at large. And then comes the Hajj to get all the Muslims together once in the lifetime as the big conference, if you like. So this is the philosophy of the five pillars of Islam, if you like. This is not Islam in its entirety, but it's just the pillars of Islam, the most essential pillars of it. And then comes the brotherhood, and comes so many things to build this beautiful building, as we explained before in Hadith Jibreel alayhi salam. Which one question that Jibreel, when he came and asked the Prophet, tell me about Islam, one answer for the first question was this, the pillars of Islam. He said, Islam is, and he mentioned those five things. And then he said, tell me about the pillars of faith, or mal iman, what is iman? And he gave him the next lesson, which is listen to, the next one, which was the articles of faith, lesson 3, and they are namely, as we all know, the to believe in Allah, to believe in His angels, to believe in His scriptures, to believe in messengers, to believe in, what else? The Day of Judgment, and the Qadr, the predestination. This is our faith, or the articles of our faith, 6 articles of faith, belief in Allah. Belief in Allah entails belief in His existence, that He is there, He exists. And the existence of Allah is eternal in both directions, no beginning and no end. To believe He is the Lord, He is the Creator, He is the Provider, He is the Caretaker, He is the Sustainer, the Cherisher. And also, Allah is the only being entitled to worship. So to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one deserving worship. Because many people say, yeah, we believe what you believe. But they do not show that. They do not submit to that God and take His will. That doesn't benefit. That faith does not benefit unless you submit to the will of this God and take Him as God. And Allah has the most beautiful and perfect names and attributes which none can be compared to. Part of our faith in Allah is to believe in all al-asma al-husna, the beautiful names of Allah, Him being the most merciful, Him being the powerful, all the names of Allah. Believe in His angels, that they exist, that they can take any form, they cannot receive any form of worship. We don't worship angels, we don't think of them as, we think of them as believers, or as, you know, those creatures of Allah made out of light to support the believers. Worship Allah, never disobey Him, but never being having any divinity, or to be worshipped, or to be asked or prayed for. No, that's not what we believe in them. Many of them are mentioned by name, but many of them are not also, are there but not mentioned. Believe in the revealed scriptures, all of them. The original scriptures, what Allah revealed to Moses and Jesus and all prophets before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam up until him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including the Quran as well. We believe in all the messengers, whether we know of or we do not know of. We also believe in the life after death, the Day of Judgment. Life after death, or Day of Judgment, or final day, which entails the following: believe that a day will come when everybody will be brought back to Allah. All of that we know. Believe in a divine decree, that Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the foreknowledge for everything that will happen, and it's inclusive and it's complete, has always known everything before it happens. Just because he's God, don't compare him, don't try to judge him by your mind. My mind and your mind are, you know, made in a certain way, but Allah, our knowledge is made in a certain way, that we acquire it, that we get it, we are ignorant, and then we acquire the knowledge, so we are knowledgeable. Allah's is different from that. His knowledge is there. It was not like zero and then it grows. It's not never like that. It is sifa lazima lahu subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the features that are with him all the time is the knowledge. And him as God and knowing everything is just normal for a God. Actually, without knowing everything, he would not qualify to be God. And we talked about this also in detail in Hadith Jibreel, which was the second question of Jibreel when he came in the form of a man in front of the Sahaba, the companions, and asked the questions. Oh Muhammad, tell me what is Islam. Oh Muhammad, tell me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is Iman, what is Ihsan? And that was the answer from Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're giving him, we're giving us all the details of these five pillars of faith and six articles of five pillars of Islam and six articles of faith. Common questions, lesson number four, and that's going to be the last one, inshallah. The common questions by recent converts usually is, do I need to change my name? Circumcision for males, for the brothers, do I have to do circumcision if I didn't do it before? Do I have to do testimony in front of people? Questions like, why is it necessary to say the two shahada, the two testimonies, verbally? What are the common Islamic greetings and terms and stuff? I have recently accepted Islam. I felt Islam brings me closer to God. Since we have already some reverts here, what of these questions will be of concern for you, or if you may have other questions? And again, I am trying to just put everything on the table. Do not, you know, feel that I don't have to ask this question. It's simple. No. If you need to ask what is Jazakallahu khair on me, just hypothetically, do it. If you need to ask even what is Assalamu alaykum, so feel free. What are the most common questions for you? Or what do you think you want to hear from these questions, the answer for these questions?
I've had kind of some argument, or then I've heard that there's a progressive, you know, Shia, Sunni, and I'm like, I'm just Muslim, you know. But now I hear this movement that's progressive,
and
I'm like,
and did you figure out what kind of Muslims are you?
I'm just a Muslim.
Regular Muslim. just a regular Muslim.
I was asked the same question. He was like, you know, God came with me, he says, okay, what kind of Muslim are you?
Christian Muslim.
I said, what other color? You know, my question to him was, what other color Muslim is it? I said, what are you talking about? There is only one Muslim. We are just Muslim. There's no label on it. It's just Muslim. I said, I can't put a label on my faith. And he kind of just looked at me and he goes, okay. He just walked away. he didn't get what I said. I told him, I can't put a label on this. And I said, I don't want to put a label. I said, there's no label that I could even come up with.
The reality is, we do have labels out there talking about even gods. As Allah said, La ilaha illallah, the testimony of faith. There is no god. There are gods out there in reality, but they are not rightfully worshipped. So there are labels that people are putting on them. But are they right or wrong? Islam is what Prophet Muhammad wrote to us. Islam is what's in the Quran. So, believe me, the purest Muslims are the reverts. They come, newly born, reverting, reformatting, coming back to zero again, or to plain blank again. That's the kind of Muslim that you are, which is the original Muslim, if you like. So, no labels. We don't want to talk about
why is that? Why is that? The label as far as I hear this progressive Muslim, you know, this me, what I feel is you can do what you want to do, you know.
But progressive Muslim? This is the first time you hear
this. This is what I said. I just, I've been hearing lately.
I guess if that question is coming from a Christian, I would assume that because there are so many, what type of Christian? Each one, each denomination is literally a religion. Catholicism is a religion, this is a religion. So they probably assume that we have all of these labels and all of these things, but we don't. I totally disagree with the, Islam is here, the five pillars. So we are going to be different in the way we look at things, in the way we even practice things, in the way we perceive things. And that's totally right, totally okay. As long as you're within certain limits. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us different. But when you put the label, when you start calling your way of doing things is the way and adding things to you being Muslim, who was sammakum al-Muslimin? Allah said, it is He who named you Muslim. So why do we seek other names? Or we're all Muslims. You do things differently, fine. Sahaba, many of them, as far as the little details, they would do it differently. But at the end of the day, the core of Islam itself, it was so pure in their heart that it will get them together. So we don't have, obviously we don't have to have any labels other than Islam is, it is black Muslim, American Muslim. I'm a Muslim. Okay. Any questions that you want to ask? Common questions that you come across? Or that you have, you may have?
I have come upon a common question is people ask, are you going to change your name? I'm like, no. And they said, okay, well, I've seen guys that come in and they, you know, people have come into Islam and they immediately change their names and all like that. And I have to go back to the originals. They came into, none of them changed their names. When I think about it, it's they all are still the same person they came into Islam is. So I feel like, you know, that's not a thing that I have to outwardly change my name to the world to proclaim that I'm into Islam and I'm a Muslim. And you know, I felt that way about it. Now if I want to have a name that which I call amongst my friends, yes, of course, you know. But as far as changing your name physically and all like that, I was born Tim, I'm going to be Tim, until I'm put in the ground. So
changing the name in itself is not something bad.
No.
But some people might think it's necessary or you have to do it, and the answer is no, you don't have to do it. It's a choice that you decide to make. Like the choice you decide to make when you decide to, you know, buy some special clothes or you like that style, something to reflect your identity, something to, somebody might decide, I'd like to have a Muslim name or an Islamic name or a name that has a good meaning in it or something. That is a choice that you make and it's good, but it's not a must in any way. If you like to keep your name, that's totally fine. So it's simply a choice that everybody is allowed to do, maybe if they want to, but it's not a must.
And you know, this day and age, it's an act of Congress to change a name. So you have to go through everything, especially with the Social Security Administration. Wow, you know, you don't want to have to go through all that.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah, it really is. Man makes it just, you know, legal things that you have to go through. I'm like, okay, no, this is a little bit much.
Okay.
Yeah.
Other questions, sisters?
I have a question that's off topic. You know when we say through, sudur, and throughout? So, how wise it all behind his hearts?
He always asks questions, Sister Farida. That would need a research. Okay. But yeah, very, very good questions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or Arabic in general, which is something I know that you are fascinated with, like many people. So many derivatives. We had actually the dean of the Arabic language college in Egypt, who was the brother of Dr. Tamam Tawabi. He was visiting us. And here, the last week, he just left. Him and his wife, both of them teaching there, he's PhD. And so they are the experts in this field, and we had a meeting with him, and I was enjoying asking him all of these kind of questions about Arabic and deep meanings and stuff. But yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might say qalb, or qulub, heart, and then sadr, or chest, and then fu'ad. So generally speaking, there are so many shades of meaning into each one of them that will make you use this in here but not the other. That will make the usage of one word over the other is preferred over the other. So fu'ad, for example, is the core of the heart, is the very core of the heart in one shade of the meaning. Heart, if you like, is like the lots that your house is built on, the entire thing. So the house and the backyard, the front yard, the area around it, all of that is the heart. If this is the heart, this is an example. The fu'ad of it, or the core of it, is going to be like the living room, maybe, or the inside of your house, or maybe the bedroom in there. So it's part of the big thing that is so deep in there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَى فَارِغًا, which means the mother of Moses, when she, Allah inspired her after Pharaoh was, he had a dream, and somebody interpreted for him that your kingdom is going to come to an end at the hand of a boy from Bani Israel, from the Israelites who were in Egypt. He ended up killing ordering to kill every newborn boy. Musa alayhi salam was born, his mother was totally, you can imagine, afraid for him. So Allah inspired her that when they come, when the soldiers come, put him, throw him into the river. Put him in a basket to float and just put him in there. And don't worry about it, we will take care of him. And she, being a faithful woman, she had all the faith in Allah and she didn't feel anything. It's the sakina, the tranquility from Allah. But then after she put him, Allah said, وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَى فَارِغًا إِنْ كَادَتْ لَتُبْدِي بِهِ. The heart, the fu'ad, and he used this fu'ad, which is the deepest, the core of the heart of Musa, become kind of vacant in such a way that she was إِنْ كَادَتْ لَتُبْدِي بِهِ لَوْلَا أَرَّبَطْنَا عَلَى قَلْبِهَا, that she was about to make it clear for everybody, did I do that? She was about to go crazy at a certain point, and he used the term fu'ad. When the core, when this made it, when the fact made it all the way to her heart, and she felt this vacuum because of the loss of her very infant, that literally almost caused her to burst. Had it not been for the fact that we rabatna ala qalbiha, that we, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that we fixed or fastened or supported her heart in total, in totality. So she was, as a mother, from the very core of her heart, from the fu'ad, after she put him in the water and water took him, she was, because of that feeling that made it to the deepest part of her heart, she was about to tell, she was about to go crazy. She couldn't, take it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at this point قال ربطنا على قلبها, that we literally kind of tied or fixed over her heart. Meaning we put it back and we give her, we calm her down and we give her tranquility. So that gives you a shade of the meaning between qalb and fu'ad. Qalb is the big thing, fu'ad is the core of this qalb. And obviously the chest is what is the bigger cover. Is whatever it is, the qalb is in there, or the heart is in there. Qalb also does not only refer to the heart in our chest. It refers to this, definitely, and to something bigger than this. The internal dimension of you. The inside of you, yes.
Quick question. Pronounce that and spell that for me, so that for somebody that doesn't speak full Arabic, could know what
the let's word use is. The technology in here somehow. I hope it will work. I know my kids like this, so we can use it for something beneficial for the first time. So, here, not here. Should be somewhere here. Okay. So one of them is I need that eraser then. It's not gonna be easy. Okay, so one of them is this qalb. You see that? So this letter here is what? It's qaf. This letter here is lam, and this letter here is da. And you put them together as in the top here, becomes qalb. Qalb, yeah. Which is heart.
Heart.
Yeah, this is qalb. Tayyib, where is the eraser? Here. You have to get egg to deal with that. She will be better than you. The other word is fu'ad. Fa, this letter in here is fa. This letter is here is hamza on the well. This alif and this is da. Fu'ad, which is the core of the heart. Fu'ad. Yeah, fu'ad.
Okay.
Right? And the other word, third word was sadr. Sadr. This is sad, this is dal, and this is ra. Sadr is the chest.
Sadr.
Yeah, the chest. All of this was a singular. If you want the plural, plural is qulub, hearts. Plural of the other word was afida. 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 Plural of the third word was sudur. Allah said, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَى الْأَبْصَارِ. Indeed, it's not the eyesight that did blind, وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَى الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. But the hearts that are in the chests that really did blind. Right? Once one person was asked, how do you learn wisdom? Or where did you learn wisdom from? He said, from the blind person. He uses the stick to check before he steps. So wisdom is to really check, to really think before you say something or do something, or just filter it. So it's not eyes that get blind, it's hearts that get blind, hearts in the chest. So this is a couple of shades on the meaning, but there are so much more into that, and some many scholars talking about heart and layers of the heart. And Allah talking about this, about khatam Allah ala qulubihim, how when the faith gets to the heart and it fills the heart from within and mixed with it, or the other way around, hypocrisy, when it gets really deeper and deeper into the heart. And many scholars, I remember one of my shuyukh, he was saying, ma'asi will keep coming to you, disobedience or sins, I mean, they will come to you, and again, they use the example of the house, and there is the backyard, the front yard, and then there is the building itself. So if you do not clean outside the house, keep it clean from inside and out. If you just ignore it a little bit, then dust and leaves will be on the outside. And if you keep it, even ignore it, even more dust will come over the building from outside. And if you abandon it or ignore the sins, ignore shaitan and his waswasa, it will keep coming in, and dust will be inside of the house. And if you keep ignoring, it will be totally messy from inside and out. So he was basically saying that you have to have the front line and pushing away sins and use the tawbah and repentance and all of that to clean everything, you know, when it first comes. So there's so many shades into that meaning. Jazakallah khair for asking the questions. And you, if you have anything to share, feel free, inshallah.
Is there any other words used for this in the Quran?
To refer to the heart?
Yeah, I mean, I'm only thinking of this. is three.
You got three, and mashallah, qalb, fu'ad, which is heart, and the core of the heart, fu'ad, sadr, in general words like batin, what's inside of them, batin or bawatin. Yeah, that's what I can think of, words that refer to the inside. Mm-hmm. Wallahu a'lam. Right. Anything else before we conclude? Let's make a quick dua, inshaAllah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. Oh Allah, bless this gathering, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, bless our gathering. Oh Allah, give us rahmah, give us mercy, give us jannah, give us paradise, give us heaven, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Make us brothers and sisters who are truly Muslims and submit themselves for your sake, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, forgive our sins, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Oh Allah, make our hearts and our afida and our qulub and our sudur and our chests and our core of our hearts as pure as you want them, O Ya Rabbil Alameen. Make our hearts straight for you, our tongues straight for you, our minds straight for you, our faith is straight for you, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Make us bringers of whatever is good. Make us keys for whatever is good. Make us locks for whatever is evil. Make us good for ourselves and our families and our communities and our societies and the nation, the entire ummah, the entire world. Allahumma ameen. Ameen. Thank you very much. So again, I urge everybody to share the goodness. If you see anything good, inshallah, in that, invite others, especially brothers and sisters, mainly converts, inshallah, to benefit from that. We're trying to go slowly over things like that. And if you have any questions or anything to share, also feel free. If you have suggestions, I'm always open to utilize the technology that you're having and everything. This is a local picture, by the way, Panama City Beach. Really goes to one of the other.
Yes.
Where did he take that picture from?
He is from, what is the tall building?
A condo?
Yeah, it's one of the condos. The one that you do share in Ramadan in.
Oh,
Edgewater.
Edgewater.
Yeah, I thought it was looking, it looked like it was from